I am Anders Hagstrom with The Daily Caller, and with me today is Texas Representative Dan Crenshaw. He's here to talk to us a little bit about the killing of Qasem Soleimani. He's been described as the second most powerful person in Iran. He was killed by the Trump administration in a drone strike on Thursday night. Could you tell us, was this a good move by the Trump administration?
Yeah, I do, and I think it was a necessary move. It's not a decision that was made lightly by any stretch of the imagination. We have to keep in mind that the escalation that has been occurring on the side of the Iranians. So they shot down a drone. We didn't do anything about it. They lobbed indirect fire missile attacks or rocket attacks at a U.S. base in Iraq, and we responded militarily against some of their fighters in western Iraq. And then they orchestrated an attack on our embassy, with the help of Iraqi Shia militias. So we have to ask ourselves, okay, at what point do we actually respond? At what point do we make it clear that there are consequences when you mess with the USA? And I think that's what the Trump administration did. I do think it was the right move because, I mean, these guys are operating with impunity. Not only did Soleimani do all of these things, but he felt he had the freedom of movement to arrive in Baghdad International Airport, meet with Qatar Hezbollah leader, and drive around like he owns the place. I mean, it's, you know, at a certain point we have to say enough is enough.
Mm-hmm. And some of your colleagues on the Democratic side of the aisle have been criticizing the president, saying he wasn't super prepared for this. Ilhan Omar of Minnesota said, quote, "We are outraged the president would assassinate a foreign official, possibly setting off another war without congressional authorization, and has zero plan to deal with the consequences." Do you agree that President Trump stepped out of his authority in carrying out this attack?
No, it's pretty clear that there's authority under the War Powers Act, which specifically says that the president has the right to engage in action in order to protect U.S. property or personnel or citizens or U.S. forces, which is clearly what's been happening here. Again, I already listed the string of escalations that had occurred before that. Let's also not forget that this happened in Iraq. So the attacks on the U.S. forces happened in Iraq, and the U.S. airstrike happened in Iraq. It didn't happen in Iran. If it did happen in Iran, you could make a better argument, although I still think you have authorization under the War Powers Act, especially considering, and this is coming from Secretary Pompeo, that there was good intelligence indications that they were planning more and more of these attacks. And, again, we have to put a stop to it. As far as the escalation goes, so the Democrats use two arguments, right? One is the lack of authority, and I just debunked that one pretty quickly. The other one is the fear of escalation. Okay, fine. I understand that there's a feeling out there that, you know, we don't want to get into a fight. That's fine. But again, the they're asking the wrong questions. The wrong question is well, what they should be asking is, you know, at what point do we actually draw a red line? And it seems to me that representatives like Ilhan Omar and many others basically have no red lines. They'll continue to move those back just to avoid any kind of confrontation. And they'll always blame America first. I mean, this is the blame America first crowd. And they stick by their guns on that pretty regularly, and it's not a governing strategy. It's not a national security strategy by any means, because you never set any parameters for yourself. You never stand up for yourself. And thank God they're not in power, because it's fundamentally it's a cowardly way to go about international affairs.
Mm-hmm. And President Trump announced on Friday that the U.S. would be sending up to 3,500 soldiers into the Middle East to combat any threats from Iran. Obviously, they've threatened revenge. How do you think that revenge or whatever retaliation will manifest?
I think it'll look like a lot of the same of what we've been seeing. So the Iranians engage in surrogate warfare. This is what they do. They're quite good at it, the IRGC and Quds Force. They do it throughout the region. They spend years and years and years building capacity within their surrogate forces, usually in the form of fellow Shiites, but not always. So that's what they'll continue to do. I think I saw a tweet from Khomeini that when he announced the replacement for Soleimani, he said that the strategy will be the same. And I think that's telling. And I don't think they want to escalate. I think they now know that if they escalate further, then we will hit back 10 times harder. And we need to have that escalation dominance. And I'm thankful that the president realizes that and executed it. And it also makes me happy the Democrats are not in charge, because they apparently want to give the Iranians all of the escalation dominance. Basically, you have free reign to continue escalation, and we will not do anything. That's what that kind of thinking is what caused Khomeini to tweet out just a day or two ago, "You can't do anything." He was talking to the president. "You can't do anything." Well, obviously, we proved him wrong. But if you're in line with the Democrat strategy on this, then you would be proving him right, and in that sense, empowering them. And I don't think that's a good strategy. So I think we can see more smaller attacks. I think we should be prepared for that. I think sending additional troops to bolster our defenses in key areas is going to be important. And we shouldn't pretend that nothing is going to happen. But I think it's, I don't think we should, I think we should also not pretend that there's this false choice between doing nothing and letting ourselves get hit in the face and all out warfare. Now there's a lot of in between, and it's messy and it's not perfect, but it is what we are dealing with.
Do you think, obviously, the Democrats not being in power, it hasn't dissuaded them from trying to impeach the president, even though they have no realistic way to actually remove him from office. Do you anticipate them doing a similar thing with this authorization argument that they have? Do you think they'll start a bunch of investigations in the House of Representatives in the places that they can?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I wouldn't put anything past them. It would be on pretty weak grounds. Again, I've already talked about how clear the War Powers Act is on this particular situation. And again, this happened in Iraq, not Iran. It didn't happen in international water. It happened in a place where we already have an operational footprint, and where self-defense is a very clear argument, according to international law and the war and our own laws. So they'd have a very weak argument. And I have seen some Democrats say Trump is doing this to create a distraction because he's losing the presidency. That's on very weak footing, that kind of argument. Will they try to make it? Probably. Will they set up an entirely new impeachment inquiry? I mean, I would hope not. That would be so absurd, but, I thought the last thing was pretty absurd, too. And we're still not past that, so.
All right. Well, Representative Dan Crenshaw, thank you so much for coming on. We appreciate it.